Gospel reading is part two of the Sermon on the Mount that we are working through in four Sundays. It has separate things in it that we want to take a closer look at. It also connects well with the Isaiah text. We will dig in and unpack it and see what it may tell us about where we live in our world. But first, I need to set the context of where we are now before the review of the text. A bit of a travelogue. Text after context. There's been plenty of bad news. But Jesus said in John 10:10, I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. That means when we are confronted with a lot of bad news, while we may feel discouraged, we are not to go into a tailspin of despair. We cannot protect ourselves from the pain of others. That is the path to heartlessness. But we can also not yield to a mind-numbing loss of hope. I can feel like I am not allowed to rest or to be happy until I have done everything I possibly can to alleviate the hellacious suffering of all people everywhere. But that is a kind of grandiosity that overestimates my ability, my capacity for action. In chaplaincy training, I learned a great truth. The needs of the world are infinite, and our ability to heal is finite. We do what we can with what we have, where we are. And that is enough. I know a very wise therapist who described a two-part coping strategy for dealing with current events, active coping and passive coping, with no judgment on either term. Passive coping includes things like regulating media intake to certain times of the day or a certain number of hours, doing things that have nothing to do with the news, like reading books, walking or exercising, seeing fun movies like La La Land, which is really a fun movie. And finally, the basics of self-care, getting plenty of sleep, drinking enough water, and eating right so things do not throw us off kilter. When we feel sad, it is easy to say, what difference does it make? But that actually pushes you deeper into the sadness. Then there is active coping. What can I actually do? You can make phone calls to elected officials, organize research groups that challenge falsehoods that are circulating. You can start getting candidates ready for the next election, etc. It's a great source of social interaction, a way of joining together in community in ways we may not have done before. I have two friends who kind of know each other, but through Facebook they were sharing so many messages that they're going to meet with like-minded people on a Sunday afternoon and form an action group to pool their energy and organize their efforts. And on nights if we are too mad to go to sleep, instead of turning on the light and digging into the internet for more incendiary news, like I do, we should just lie there and meditate or pray or just listen for the voice of God, for God to speak in the quiet of the night. God speaks, but we don't know that unless we spend some time listening. This week I met with someone who does a prison ministry. She's a Baptist with a Master of Divinity degree, but she is not allowed to preach. She has been trying to crack open a prison ministry because Jesus said, I was in prison and you visited me. She has had false starts. So she works at Macy's and puts together a newsletter for prisoners with Bible lessons. I mentioned that Presbyterians ordain women. And she nodded painfully. She is determined, though, and she said she has learned to be quietly forceful about my faith. I don't force it on anyone, but I also don't back down. She uses soft power. I also went to a Thursday discussion group at the community center where the speaker had helped launch the Dignity Restored Initiative in Uganda, and is in the process of building a miracle village of hope and healing for young women and their children who are now trapped in a cycle of poverty and prostitution. She spoke about how she came to realize that ordinary, everyday people can change the world. The Uganda mission is about refugees from Uganda and the nations around it, which are caught up in wars that create thousands of refugees, many of whom end up in Uganda. The United States is the world's most successful arms dealer, selling all kinds of weapons to the drug lords of Mexico and the warlords of Africa. But as a nation, our government does not help to clean up afterwards. That would be akin to taking responsibility for our actions. So what is left are women who have been abused by soldiers, turning to prostitution to support their children, and then the children becoming prostitutes. Children prostitutes. Sounds like Minneapolis. Jesus hung out with prostitutes. In his time and in ours, most women in the sex trade have been forced into it by circumstance. I liked how they called it the Dignity Restored Initiative, because that is one of the phrases that came out of the Families Moving Forward program center downstairs, that the place has to look shiny and beautiful to restore the dignity of the families. The last Presbytery meeting was held at Kwanzaa, the predominantly African-American Presbyterian church in North Minneapolis. Reverend Alika Galloway was there, and you may have seen her speak here at a Tuesday dialogue curated by Gordon Stewart. They have a mission to sex workers in Minneapolis. She reminded us that the average sex worker starts at the age of 14, when the average price of a trick is $10. Average. They have two church buildings. A small one has been turned into an outreach mission to sex workers, a drop-in center where they can get something to eat and drink and someone to talk to. They don't proselytize. They don't lecture. They listen and they respond. I bring this up because today is Super Bowl Sunday, the number one day of sex trafficking in the United States, especially in the city where the event takes place. And it is taking place in Minneapolis next year, one of the leading cities in America for sex trafficking. And the customers? The clients who drive the business are white men, making $100,000 a year, who live in the suburbs. Between now and next year, this topic will come up again. One story that came out at Presbytery was that many of the sex workers do only 4 or 5 tricks a month. And when do they do it? When rent is due. Affordable housing is not always available. Available housing is not always affordable. Minimum wage does not pay the rent, does not always pay the rent. Reverend Alika said that a raise in minimum wages and the building of more affordable housing would help curtail the sex trafficking because it would reduce the desperation of the people who go into it. I had seen Alika speak at the last church I worked at, Church of the Apostles in Burnsville. She gave a sermon about that included a heartbreaking story of her grandmother turning a trick to put an Easter ham on the table. And when the family was gathered around the meal, she went out back and threw up again and again. Alika said, "I look like my grandmother. If you want to picture what someone looks like who has been forced into prostitution to put food on the table for her children, picture me." Jesus ministered to prostitutes. We read it in the Bible, and we find it unpleasant and painful to talk about. We would like to climb into a quiet, warm little cocoon sometimes. But we are called to know the suffering of others. And then, with what energy we have, we take action. I keep quoting Pope Francis on this. We pray for the hungry, then we go feed them. That's how prayer works. How does Jesus address these situations? Jesus starts this passage with what I think is a light and witty touch. He's speaking to us. He's speaking to you. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? Now, have you ever seen salt that isn't salty? Does salt lose its saltiness? So he's describing an impossible thing to stretch our heads. We are the salt, so be the salt. The thing that amplifies taste to our taste buds, the thing that preserves food, the valuable mineral we have to add to our system. Because once we evolved out of the sea, we needed more than we take in. Jesus says, be essential. Next joke, verse 15. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket. Okay, a bushel basket is made out of wicker or light, thin wood. You light a lamp and put it under a bushel basket, and boom, it bursts into flame. That's funny. Okay, Jesus, no one does that, of course. So Jesus says, if that is so obvious, then do the obvious thing. Shine. Be bright. Shimmer. Be gently strong in your faith. Don't force it on anyone, but here's the important thing. Do not hold back. Do not hide it. If you hide it under a bushel, you will burst into flame. Then Jesus says, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come to fulfill. We need to be careful of this verse because Jesus is not saying that we should literally do whatever the Hebrew Bible says to do, like kill anyone who doesn't come to church on a Sunday, or have our sons stoned to death if they give us back talk. The text from Isaiah is paired with this gospel because God wants us to fulfill it. God tells us in verse 1, shout out, do not hold back, lift up your voice like a trumpet, announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Prophetic language, again, is not the ability to predict the future. It means to call out a people or a king to live up to their own standards, to follow their own laws, to be true to their best aspirations. And here, God is saying, speak up. The people are in rebellion to my word. They fast, they go through the motions, but they are not true of heart. Fasting is supposed to be a means of purification. It's supposed to bring us to a steadily higher plane of consciousness. Verse 3, the people say, why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? God replies, look, you serve your own interests on your fast day and oppress your workers. In other words, you are faking it, and you only fake out yourselves. I see your actions. If fasting doesn't transform how you are, how you treat people, then you have missed the point. You have failed to make meaning of your religious actions, rendered them useless, made salt unsalty. Let's close with a revised take on the Psalms we read today. Happy are those who hold God in awe, who greatly delight in knowing and following the commandments. Their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness of bad news and stand as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. They shine. They are resilient. It is well with those who deal generously, who lend and do not expect to be repaid, who conduct all their affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. They are not afraid of evil tidings. They are not encumbered by bad news. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. Their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid. They have distributed freely. they have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. The sound of their voice is exalted in honor. The wicked see it and are angry. They gnash their teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked comes to nothing. The wicked see it and are angry. The wicked are angry. But the righteous, whom we strive to emulate, they are not afraid of evil tidings. They are not encumbered by bad news. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. They are happy and they shine. Let us pray. Dear God, our great Creator, who gave us a universe full of millions of galaxies and also made the atoms and molecules and quarks, the infinitesimal materials that make up our world, help us to be both informed and at peace, to be both in empathy and in resolve, to be tender and to be strong. The narrow path is hard, but that is what we are called to take, to carry the burdens that others leave aside. Be with us in our solitude and when we are in community. All this we ask in your name. Amen.